and client partners on the call with us today, as well as people just getting to know CCL. My name is Tracy Dobbins, and I'll serve as your host today. For those of you that are new to CCL, we are a top 10 ranked provider of executive education globally. We work with two-thirds of the world's top 500 companies, small business and government, providing innovative solutions for the entire organization and programs proven to transform the individual. Our work is based on significant research, from our own elite teams to the finest global sources, and we share it with you today in this discussion. Before our presenter begins, we would love participation and invite you to use the chat tool provided on the right side of your screen. You can ask questions or interact with the presenter. Simply direct your chat to all participants. And if you need to speak directly with myself, just send it to host, presenter, and panelist. We will have a webinar evaluation at the end of the session, and we will shoot out a poll to you to get your thoughts about today's session. And we will have a formal question and answer session at the end of the webinar. Finally, look for a link to the recorded version of the webinar and other related resources in your inbox tomorrow. Now, I'd like to introduce our presenter. With us today is Lisa Sinclair. She's a global portfolio manager and senior faculty with the Center for Creative Leadership. She contributes to the Center's leadership solutions through design and delivery of customized global leadership development programs for clients in various industries. She also serves as a subject matter expert on experiential learning and is lead faculty for the Leadership Development Program and the Leading Change Program. She has partnered on leadership solutions with clients from a variety of industries and brings more than 18 years of leadership experience to her role in the classroom. Welcome, Lisa.
Thank you, Tracy, and welcome to everyone on the phone. I'm excited to be here with you all today, wherever you are, all around the world. You know, one of the things that we know is that getting organizational results keeps getting more difficult, and so we want to look at how we might be able to really leverage and harness the power of influencing to be a game changer as you go about your work. But I'd like to start with just understanding a little bit more about what brings you here. So I have a couple of options for you on the screen, just to get a sense of what it is you hope to get out of our session today. And hopefully all of you can choose at least one of those options. Give you just a few minutes to do so.
All right, looks like they're coming in now. All right, we'll keep it open just a few more seconds, and we'll share the results. All right. Tallying up the final results now. Okay, Regina, can you show us the results? Like 78% want to increase my ability to influence more effectively. Great.
Excellent. There we go.
All right. And all of the above, 20%.
Great.
Good. Well, good. Well, hopefully we'll be able to meet your needs here today. Thank you for the
responding. Yeah, thanks. That's very helpful to have that the insight. I'm so used to seeing people in front of me, so this is a great way to get that information. So here's what we're hoping to do today. One is we really want to spend just a few minutes talking about why influence is not only important, but why it's becoming more important for us. Also looking at some key elements of effective influence, things that you can leverage moving forward. We want to give you an opportunity to assess your current capabilities and your competency around influence, as well as identify opportunities to develop more effective influence moving forward, so some practice opportunities. At the end of the session, we'll talk a little bit about how you can begin applying some of the things that you've learned here today. But it only makes sense that we would start our time together with an understanding of what influence means. So let's look at a working definition for our session. We think about influence today as the ability to affect the behavior of others in a particular way. And we're looking at, in the context of an organization, how do you really move people towards something, get them engaged, get them excited, get them on board. get them participating. Influence is absolutely critical, and we know it's important from our childhood as we try to influence our friends what games to play, all the way up to colleges as you leave high school and go to universities, convincing and influencing your friends to go to the same school with you, and then into the work world where we're trying to influence people towards some organizational result. And so with this definition in mind, I want you to be thinking about, as we go through the webinar, what your expectations are in terms of your own influence. So be thinking about, this is sort of a rhetorical question for you, but if you could become more effective at influencing, what would be the payoff to you? What would be the benefit or the value? My suspicion would be that if you could get more effective at influencing, that you would be able to get work done more quickly, more efficiently, probably come up with better solutions through the involvement and excitement of others. So as we go through, be thinking about what the payoff is, because if you are, in fact, trying to become more influential, you'll need motivation, and that will help serve that purpose. So let's talk a little bit about why influence matters. There's a lot of reasons why. Some that we know from our research is the world now is much more complex, and we have constant change. And in order to change, that requires us to influence people to move in a different direction. Our organizations are flatter or more matrixed, so no longer can we simply rest on hierarchical power to influence to get things done. We're having to influence across the organization. We have more team approaches to our work. Oftentimes, those team members are geographically dispersed around the world. We also know that decision-making and time issues generated by increased collaboration have a big input on our ability to get the work done. And so how do we influence in that environment of more collaboration? And then final, I'm sure it's not the final definition, the final reason why influence matters, but the last one for our slide is culture and diversity. So we see the world differently, we come from different backgrounds, and as we become more globally integrated, being able to understand what's important to others and leverage that in influencing folks is really important. We know that influence is a fundamental skill that leaders must master in order to be successful in organizations. They don't just tap the knowledge and skills of a group, but they also point individuals toward common goals and draw out commitment for them to achieve their results. We want more than compliance in our work. So when we think about hierarchical power, we're thinking about the ability to tell someone, you know, as your boss, I'd like for you to do this. And what we often get from that is compliance. But in a world of complexity and change and matrix organizations, we need to get people engaged on their own accord and get beyond compliance to this thing I call discretionary effort. So how do you get people to tap above and beyond what is the basic requirements to get engaged in the work, to be willing to highlight and call to your attention challenges in the direction in which you're facing or the project on which you're working? We want them to be fully engaged. And so effective influence is absolutely critical to that process. So I want to start with data. So before this webinar, most of you had opportunity to complete a behavioral self-assessment on influence. And I ask you to look at your skills around influence and identify, of the items listed in that assessment, where you had a clear strength, something you knew you were good at, or an area where you think you have a clear developmental need. Now, most of you will have many blanks on here. It's not an option where we're trying to get you to check one or the other for every answer, but to really take a discerning look at how you show up in terms of influence and where you have strengths that you may leverage as you move forward versus opportunities you know that already exist in terms of your skill set around influencing. And as we go through, we'll ask you to think back to your responses. Think about how many strengths you have versus development needs. Also look at the trends in terms of your responses. Do you see trends in those categories? And we'll cover a lot of those as we go through. And be identifying as we continue our discussion where are the areas that you might want to work? If you haven't had a chance to complete this survey, it will be made available to you, and I strongly suggest you take 5 to 10 minutes to walk through those questions and just do a good self-assessment. We also know there are other ways you can tell whether or not you are already influential, at least to some degree. And you can see on the screen we have 10 here that are clear indicators that you are at least to some degree influential. One is, can you work around policy or rules? Are you able to get things done despite, let's say, the bureaucracy in your organization? What is your access to vital information? How much do you know? How much are you hearing through others in the organization? How involved are you in important decisions? I'll skip to how often do you see executives show up at your desk or at your office to ask for your input? Can you influence changes outside your functional area or outside your role? Are you able to influence and can influence or drive change in areas outside your responsibility? Your access to resources. Are you copied on correspondence? So as people are communicating changes in different parts of the organization, are you finding yourself included on those communications? Have you been targeted for development or promotion? We know that people who are top leadership see as influential are seen as more promotable. And so are you being tapped for new opportunities? Are you being asked to coach or mentor others? Maybe there's someone else lower in the organization from you or in a different part of the organization who someone thinks you might be value add to them in terms of coaching them around getting the work done. You can also think about the degree to which you're included in special events, work, and non-work related. How much people think of you when activities are going on. And, of course, the last one, which I've already mentioned, the frequency with which senior leadership show up at your desk and ask for your input or even just engage in conversation. So 10 ways you can already begin to determine, in addition to the questionnaire, where you have strengths in terms of being seen as influential. So today what we want to do is add on to what I'm sure is already some great starts to effective influence, and we're going to look at 5 key components or elements of effective influence. There's self-assessment, and for those of you who've completed that handout prior to the webinar, you're one step in the right direction already. We're going to look at deliberately building foundations with others, influencing others by involving them, influencing through connection at an emotional level, and we'll talk a little bit more about what that means. And finally, building and sustaining momentum that you've already gotten. So let's take a look at each one of these a little deeper. So first, self-assessment. This is exactly what it sounds like. How well do you know yourself and how you show up in situations where you're able to influence others? Are you clear about your strengths and your developmental opportunities? Are you aware of your emotional triggers, how you respond? Oftentimes, things that are our strength in one area, we overuse them, and influence is a place where that can get us into trouble. What will it take for you to be more aware of your choices? So if you know that you have a particular challenge or a particular strength, what can you do to be more aware of how you're showing up? It's all about knowing yourself first, and we know this to be true in all phases or components of leadership. As human beings, we tend to work from a place of strength, and that's what got us this far. What we want to do is figure out where are our gaps, and that's what self-assessment is all about. Doing a thorough self-assessment provides you with ideas and approaches that you can leverage that you might not even have thought of yet. Whatever method you choose, knowing that you're self-aware, being emotionally intelligent about your reactions, how you're being perceived by others and experienced by others is absolutely critical to effective influence. The next component that we want to look at is building a foundation with others. It's all about relationships. This happens before you need to influence people. So as you're going through your day-to-day work, who are the people that you're connected with, that you have foundations with? Are you seen as having a reputation of trust and credibility and flexibility? This is all about, you could think of it as your leadership brand. How do people see you? When you leave a room, what might they say? What image do you want to portray when you're connecting with others? So building a foundation is about the relationship. So who are you connecting with, talking with, spending time with, in order to know more, not only about them and the work that they do, but to let them have a better sense of who you are, what drives you and motivates you. Next, we have influencing others by involving them. Now, all of these things we know take time. So it's a choice, right? What are we going to spend time on? Influencing others by involving them is about building onto the relationships and getting input. It's about buy-in. Who are the people that you're connected with? Who are the people that you are inviting into decision-making, into discussions, into brainstorming? It's not one way either. It's not just how much are you influencing them, but how much do you allow their input, their involvement to influence you? People who are seen as highly effective at influencing others are also themselves willing to be influenced. So when you bring people to the table, do you let them shape and reshape your thinking, advance your thinking? Are you open to considering disconfirming views to your own? It may sound crazy, but it works. Those who are willing to be influenced first have a much better chance of influencing others. The next, we're going to look at connecting at an emotional level. And for some of you, this may feel uncomfortable. Some of us are more comfortable with dealing with the emotional level of leadership than others. But I think the way that this is designed will make more sense than what you might think just at the level of the word emotional. So how can you really make a challenge come to life for other people? What is it that motivates them and gets them excited about the work? Is there deeper meaning behind the change, something that really drives them? The leader who is emotionally intelligent can manage his or her emotions and impulses, understand the emotions of others. Are you reading body language well from other people? And they're able to inspire and influence while avoiding conflict. So it's paying attention to how other people are responding to the change, making sure that you're finding out what really excites them about the change, and how do you begin to integrate and make connections between their emotional connection to what's going on so that they can feel more a part of it, they can get behind it. I can tell you that when it comes to productivity and commitment, I give twice as much effort to something that I feel connected to and that I'm passionate about. So the idea of connecting emotionally is really important. It's about shared purpose and shared understanding. So if you're doing all of these things and you're starting to see change occur, you're starting to see your influence being able to push people, what you want to do next is really build and sustain that momentum. How do you build on what's working well? Create opportunities for success. How do you celebrate those small wins that you're making in the right direction as a means of encouragement and to validate the collaboration that you're having with others? How might you celebrate along the way, be it an email of excitement, a quick lunch, a handshake, congratulations? How do you really build and sustain that momentum? When people are seeing you being influenced and you changing your mind and flexing how you see things, and then you celebrate when they're able to do the same, it really helps charge things up and get you moving in the right direction. So, five key components of effective influence, and at a surface, they all seem fairly straightforward, and maybe even simple to some degree, but it does require time and energy. So as you're thinking about leveraging some of these components and expanding some of your skill sets, think about how you can make time to do that. Anytime we try to do something that's different from how we normally do our work, we're not quite as smooth and suave when we first start, and oftentimes it feels awkward and unusual to us. So make time for yourself to think about what you're doing. Reflect on times when you're trying to use these components, and really think about, what did I do that worked well this time, and how might I leverage that moving forward? You can also go back to your behavioral self-assessment to get a sense of where are there development opportunities in each of these categories? You may notice now as we've gone through the five components that they are tied into the questions on the self-assessment. So go back and look at those for trends and patterns of sort of larger opportunities for you to invest your energy moving forward to try some new things. So five components. So now I want to spend a few minutes thinking about application. So five quick things you can think about doing. Now, how do you think about doing that? So I'd like for you to yourselves, just think about either a current influence opportunity that you might have where you can apply these components, or it might be an opportunity to plan for future situations where you can influence. You might want to think about something that challenges your current influence. Maybe there's something you're trying to get done. You're trying to drive some results in a particular area in your organization and you're struggling. Obviously, you'd want to pick something that's going to involve other people, and those people should have some sort of vested outcome, like stakeholders, and something for which you think you have a sphere of responsibility. So be thinking about what that opportunity might be. And as you're thinking about it, I want to highlight that knowing your own influence style is one thing, but being really strategic about it is another. So if you think about influences, and again, going back to the analogy of hierarchy is no longer enough, it's really about what happens in the white space, in between the org chart, in between the process flows. It's where you might have what we refer to as unnatural alliances, connections you may make with people that would never have been suspected to be important to your influence opportunity. So be thinking about who those people are. We want you to think about stakeholders. So first thing you'd want to do is list who are the stakeholders that are involved with that influence opportunity, whether it's current or one you're planning for in the future. You might think of groups that you work with, peers across your organization. They could be people outside of your organization, vendors, partners, people that you work with and are reliant on for success. They could be above you in the organizational chart. They may be below you. They could be someone on the front line trying to get the work done. But who are those key stakeholders connected to that opportunity? And just make a list of those individuals. You might even think about people with whom you have no relationship at all yet, but are critical to this influence opportunity that you might want to consider influencing. And once you have that list, we're going to share with you some questions that link up to these five components so that you can do an analysis of what might be my next step as it relates to this stakeholder. So the first is you're going to look at sort of a self-assessment. How am I approaching this situation as a whole? So thinking about that influence opportunity, how am I approaching it? What have I tried that's not working? What have I not yet tried, either because I thought it wouldn't work or someone suggested it and I didn't like the idea? Is there a strength that you have? So if you look at your behavioral assessment, is there a strength that you might be overutilizing that's just not working? And have you allowed yourself to be open to influence by them? The next thing you want to think about is what kind of foundation have you built? So if you look across those stakeholders, what kind of relationships do you have with those individuals? Do you have none? It's just someone you know their name or you've seen their face on an org chart or pass them in the hall? Or is it someone that you have a casual relationship or maybe someone that you used to work with or work with currently? But what, do an analysis of what that relationship looks like. And is there opportunity to grow that relationship? What do you know about their challenges? What are the challenges they're facing in their part of the organization or in their role? That may or may not be connected at all to your opportunity to influence. It could be something, though, that is affecting how open they are to additional change or to shifting their perspective to a different viewpoint. So what do you know about what's going on in their world? Do you understand your work? So often in organizations, we see ourselves outside of challenges or outside of a group as opposed to putting ourselves in the middle. So how can you learn more about what they do, about their work and their challenges? How can you get to know them better as an individual? And I'm not talking about making everyone your best friend. I'm talking about acknowledging that they're human beings. What are their passions? What do they like to do? Do you make those small one-off connections? Do you both have kids who play softball? Or maybe you both have the same alma mater, or you like the same sports team. What's that one connection you can build? And what are you doing to have a reputation of trust, credibility, and flexibility with that person? How can you engage them with that, those things in mind? Next, you're going to want to look at involving them. So what does this mean? So if we're going to be involving them, how often do I involve them in the work? So think about your influence opportunity and what kinds of communications are you sending out? What kinds of meetings are you having, brainstorming sessions? Have you ever thought about reaching out and including someone in a discussion for which they have absolutely no expertise at all? They just have a different perspective. Getting their thoughts, their opinions, or their advice. How might you be able to more include people, whether it's through email, maybe it's a quick lunch conversation. The question is, how can you engage with them more? And go down that list of individuals that you identified and think about ways that you might be able to involve them a little bit more. Now, I know what you might be thinking. I can't involve everyone all the time, and please know that's not what I'm suggesting. As I mentioned earlier, knowing your influence style is important, but leveraging it strategically is even more important. So I'm saying strategically, who do you need to build relationships with over time? There's also some great theory in networking today. There's these things we call latent ties. And these are ties to individuals who we've built relationships with over time. You know, it's that friend from college or the friend from high school or from a different place of employment that even if you haven't spoken to them in 5 years, you could call them up today and it would be like you had never had a gap in conversation. It would be as if you had just spoken to them yesterday. So not all of the folks in your stakeholder list will need the same degree of attention. So you'll need to look at, you know, with those that I already have a pretty strong relationship, maybe I don't invest as much time involving them as I might with someone that I'm just sort of bringing into my arena of stakeholders. So involving them is the next key thing. So let's get back to this idea of emotional connection. So oftentimes, people don't know what's driving our own passion and vision for a change or for a redirection. So what's incumbent upon us as leaders is to share with other people our own vision. What is our passion? Why is this important to us? Why is this important to the organization? How would this help us meet organizational objectives? Have I shared with them what capabilities they have that are critical? So if you look at your stakeholder list, who on that list has capabilities that would be very helpful for you in driving whatever organizational results you're trying to achieve? Have you told them that that capability is needed? Have you articulated that maybe that's a gap in the work team that would be of advantage? I remember a specific example recently for me. We're in the middle of designing a new program. And I wanted really different kind of thinking. And so I asked someone to involve that group who had never designed a leadership program in their life. They came from a very different industry. They came from the oil and gas industry. And I invited them, one, because I thought it would be an opportunity for them to learn something new about the organization. But I also thought it would be a great opportunity for them to bring a very different lens to the work and almost more of a learner in the seat in the classroom lens. And so we invited this individual, and I cannot tell you the value add that that person had to that work. They asked questions I would have never thought about asking. They found gaps and opportunities that we had not even uncovered. And so who are those people for you who you can bring in to share your vision, who have capabilities that you might not even realize could be valuable? And then ask them to get involved. Ask them to talk about how this would be impactful to them. What would be their desired income outcome? What would be a vision in this work that would get them motivated and excited? And then if you think about what I just did, what stories do you have that you can tell and share that really get people excited about the change at hand? What is it that they can bring to bear that help illuminate what it is you're trying to accomplish? So many times we in our own minds are really clear about the change we're trying to drive or the results we're trying to reach. And sometimes it's only through a story that that really comes to life for other people. So what stories can you be telling to get people really deeply connected? Again, you're looking for discretionary effort above and beyond what's required as you're trying to drive toward these organizational results. Last, building and sustaining momentum. So many times we'll get finished with a project, we'll get to the end, we'll be ready to implement, and we never take time to really think about what worked well. So what are some small ways that we can agree early? So if you're thinking about a big project, let's say you're trying to influence the organization to look at another distribution channel, for example, that's a pretty big change, could be a big change for an organization. You might want to back into that a little differently and say, what are some small ways that we could agree? Perhaps it's just identifying that you need more channels to reach your customers than you originally had thought. So what are those small little incremental changes, small ways where you can find agreement? That will help you build and get some momentum moving forward. Of course, celebrate those when you get them. Find out all the things that you have in common and celebrate those. You'll also want to think about what can I concede in order to get that early win. So when I think back to my example of designing a program and bringing in someone who I thought had immense business capabilities, I thought, how could I really get this person energized into the work? And I had some pre-existing notions of what I thought would be the right answer. But what I did was when she came in, there were some areas pretty quickly that were evident to me that if I gave her an opportunity to really begin shaping, if I allowed myself to be influenced by her, it got her really motivated. And so she began getting more and more excited. She brought more and more ideas to the table. And so what I thought was important to do is to recognize that. And so the last piece of building and sustaining momentum is, how do you really recognize that contribution? And so some ways that I did that with this particular project was I sent an email out in summary, and I said, here, you know, thanks to Tracy for some of the great ideas around, you know, and I listed those items out. So I called attention to their contribution. And what I found that's occurred, at least for me in that particular example, is that she comes to each follow-up meeting with a renewed sense of energy. She's actually been thinking about it since we last spoke and has actually reached out to other key people that she knows who also have ideas in this space. And so she's brought other resources to bear. So the best thing to do is to take that list of stakeholders and go through those questions. When I did this for myself, I created a table and I had a column with the names of my individuals, and then I just did a little analysis of who are the most critical people for me to connect with now, to bring them in the fold, to get their ideas, to build a foundation with, to connect with them around their passions and their interests, all in the purposes of really advancing the organizational results. And then finally, really thinking about once I got them engaged in the work, how do I build and sustain that momentum moving forward? So, five components of influence, some questions that you can use to analyze your stakeholders, and it's fairly simple. So I'd love to hear some of your questions or thoughts.
Great, thank you, Lisa. First question from Anne. I was part of an executive team with a high level of influence, but recently left the team of my own accord due to high level of dysfunction. How do I have influence now outside the executive level?
Oh, that's a great question. And I would say for, thanks, Anne, I would say for anyone out there who is on an executive team or in a group, and if you look at that stakeholder list, make sure that there are people outside of that function. So, Anne, what I would say is find out who are some key people in the organization. It could be names that you hear of often in conversation. It could be people who you're seeing getting some unique opportunities, and start building those relationships now. Start with the foundation. What might be ways that you can connect with them, whether it's just go and find out what their part of the organization does, ask to come and get an overview. It could be invite them to lunch just to get to know them. But I would start with building foundations, and who are some key people across the organization who might be helpful for you in your career, in making connections in other places across the organizations in order for you to get the work done. But I would start by finding out who are some of those other key players across the organization who have a lot of institutional knowledge or a lot of expertise that you can begin connecting with.
Great. And we have a question from Stephen. Would there be a benefit in having your boss or peers complete the assessment based on their perception of you? And comparing the two assessments might provide interesting insights.
Oh, I love that idea, Stephen. I think that's a great idea. So if you have comfort with that, one of the best ways to find out if your influence is working or not is to ask other people. So if you have folks who you think could give you some insight, it would be a great way to do that. You could do it with peers, and you know, this is a tool that we're providing for you just for attending the webinar. So share it with other people in your organization, even your team. You know, a leader is only as effective as their team is, right? So how can you help your team learn ways to be more influential? But I love the idea of getting insights from other people in terms of how you're doing from an influence perspective. You could also ask them, who are the people that you're not connected with that you should be? Or, you know, are you missing something? There's a gap in your network of folks that you're working with that you might need to tap into. Great idea.
And from Kova, how can we help managers influence their staff? What kind of coaching tips can we give them?
Oh, that's great. Kova, I would say the same tips we just gave you. The number one reason that people, I think, and this is from my own personal experience, are not influential is because, one, we don't really listen to others, and we don't know others' perspective. So, you know, first seek to understand. Many of you probably heard that saying. So how do you reach out to other people and really listen for understanding first, try and understand their point of view first? And again, it falls back into the relationship as the number one element of influencing, is having a strong relationship. Even if it's just purely a business relationship where your reputation is you do what you say you're going to do every time, you're honest and transparent, but really start with building that foundation. I do a lot of coaching of people in individual contributor roles. I'm really passionate about sharing my, I'll call them learning opportunities. Many people may call them, you know, horrific failures or mistakes that I've made along the way. But the number one thing I will attribute my ability to be influential with two is the ability to build relationships across the enterprise. I also do something called one-minute favors, where you do something for someone with no expectation for anything back. I have something I learned, and I see Tracy in the hallway, and I say, "Hey, Tracy, you know, I just now that I'm seeing you, this might be interesting for you to know." And I'm just telling her that because. So how do you then share that with others? So really work with your team around who are the people they need to be building foundations with, and start there.
Question, how do you influence without authority over another function or group?
Oh, that's good. You know, and I hate to sound like a little bit of a broken record. Again, it's about building foundations. The center has done, and if you haven't seen this, you can get access to this on our website. We've done a lot of research around boundary spanning, and one of the first couple of things that anyone needs to do is they're spanning organizational boundaries, going across function, across geographic space, is to create safety. So establish what boundaries are there. You go in and you learn what other people are doing, what their work is like, and that builds respect. And then the third is really listen to what their challenges are, and that begins to build trust. And those three things really help you go across organizational boundaries. So again, first, seek to listen. Hear about the other group's challenges, what they're doing, commiserate if you have similar challenges, find some small things that you have in common, and then build on those. But it really starts with that foundation of
wanting to understand others first.
Samantha asks, how do you suggest influencing executive management for compliance issues when the individuals don't want to be involved in the process and are not emotionally connected to the task?
Oh, how much time do we have, Tracy? If I could solve that problem in a quick answer, I would be a very wealthy lady. You know, when someone really doesn't want to do something, it's very hard to get them to move. I would say, again, to go through the steps that we've mentioned here in this webinar. Can you scroll up just a bit? In the webinar, angels don't want to do, and that would be about. And not everyone's going to connect at emotional level. So I know some of you on the call probably heard that, and, you know, they're you immediately, the hair on the back of your neck stood up, emotional. But it's really about what are people passionate about. So when you're trying to deal with someone who is really difficult, I try and find out what motivates them. What are they really about? Is it just the bottom line, the organizational results? And if so, then use that as a lever. What is it that they are passionate about? How can you give them credit for being involved with something? But really, it's about figuring out motives and intentions. What motivates people and what are their intentions around the organization?
Liz asks, what if we're completely uncomfortable with the concept of exerting influence, the fakeness of cultivating people, et cetera? Any low-stakes ways to build that comfort level internally?
Let me say effective influence is not about being fake, and I understand where your comment was coming from. You have to, this is why you do a self-assessment. What are small ways that you can begin to build those foundations? I had a former boss once who was not touchy-feely. I'm a hugger. He wouldn't hug people. He didn't share a lot about him personally. But what he did that was perfect was that he would hear small things that were important to me, and then he would follow up. For example, my mom was sick once, and he stopped by on a Monday and said, hey, I know your mom wasn't doing well. I just wanted to make sure everything was okay. That's all he said, and that's all he did. He wasn't really warm and fuzzy. He didn't get into a deep personal sort of emotional conversation. He just let me know that he realized something else was going on for me. And that's one simple way that you can start building those foundations with people. It's simple. It's easy. It's no frills. Hey, your kid had a baseball game this weekend. How did it go? Or it could be, I saw your presentation. That was really great. But those small little things that you can do to connect and build foundations, it could be something as simple as sharing some information with someone.
Samara asks, one of the questions on the self-assessment list relates to a sense of politics. What would be your advice on improving in that area?
Oh, well, the first thing, Samara, and hopefully I'm saying your name correctly, the one thing I would suggest there is identify people within your organization who you believe are politically savvy. Who are the people, the movers and shakers, who know how to navigate the organization effectively? And go talk to them. Invite them to lunch and say, I'd really love to, you know, pick your brain, to ask you some questions. I want to get better at navigating the organization, and I'm not really good with the politics. So ask someone who you think does it well and get insights from them, and then pick what I call a tiny little goal for yourself of something you're going to try and do differently and see how it works. But don't reinvent the wheel. Go ask people who you see or are seen in the organization as being really, really strong with that.
Carol states, I'm not on the executive team but have relations with others in the organization. How do I use my position to influence and leverage when I'm not in a leadership role but am often working on teams with leaders?
Yeah. So, Carol, what I would, a couple of things to think about. You could identify of those list of leaders that you work with someone that you could trust that could be a coach or mentor and just ask them. You know, one of the things I want to do is to be, you know, more effective in influencing and having an impact on organizational decisions. What are the things that I could bring to bear that would help me do that? I think so oftentimes we think we have to come up with all the answers. And I just said to Tracy this morning as we were setting up the webinar, I am all about shamelessly borrowing great work from other people. And so ask people, what are things that you could bring to the table that could influence? It could be data. You know, it could be information that you have that would sway. It could be a perspective. It could be an idea. It could be an impact on people. But I would tap some of those leaders who you've worked with and say, you know, I'm trying to be more influential and would like to have more of an impact on our organization. What would be some ways you would suggest me doing that? And get some data for yourself. Again, go back to the self-assessment if you're unsure.
JR asks, do you see this as valuable self-assessment for those who are leading change in an organization?
I sure do. And I would also say it's important for, there's some great work out there on change and transition, not only in terms of influence, but also knowing how people go through change in organizations. Oftentimes we will look at someone's behavior and make a decision that they're anti-change or they're anti this change, and oftentimes that's not what it is at all. So, yes, any self-assessment you can do, whether it's on influence or driving change in your organization, effective leaders know themselves first, and then they look to figure out how they need to flex their style, either, you know, do more of a behavior, do less of a behavior, start, stop a behavior, in order to be effective. And that requires energy, work, and focus, paying attention to how you're being received from other people.
Patrick states he's in a management role and have influence. However, all of his peers are extremely busy with their own roles and projects. What are some ways that I can effectively pull everyone together and gain unity with regard to making big, important changes in the organization? I ask this because I've noticed that at least in my organization, it's very difficult to gain ground on your own and make them stick.
It is. So the first thing would be to see if you can get them all together, first and foremost. Can you create a compelling reason? And I go back to a lot of times when people are busy, to grab their attention, you have to think about a couple things. One, what is the organizational results that you're trying to deliver on? And what could be the impact of not doing something? So what might be the impact on them? And what's the value add to them? I hate to say it this way, but what's the carrot? You know, how do you dangle or get their attention with something that's going to have direct impact on them as an individual? The other thing you might do is ask if they really can't come to the table, do they have someone in their group who they would be willing to be a stand-in for them? A lot of times leaders will have sort of a second, someone they help get to bring in and help with decision making and big projects. It might be that there's someone else who can act sort of as a proxy. But I think you have to figure out what would be the compelling reason, what's the burning fire, if you will, that would get them engaged in the work and start from there.
Thank you. Question about what's your take on the effects of technology and the influence we have? How can we leverage the use of technology to be more effective influencers?
Oh, when we only have 10 minutes. So I have a lot of thoughts about the effects of technology. So technology is phenomenal. I've spent a fair amount of time leading large-scale technology projects in a past life. And it has so much advantages. What I think it does, though, is it does get in the way of the relationships from time to time, that it overrides. We can't see people's reaction. You know, I think I said at the start of this, one of the hard parts about a webinar for me is I like to see your faces to see, you know, if you're connecting with the content, or are you rolling your eyes at me, or are you, you know, dozing off at your desk. I can't see all of those things. So technology can help you expedite sharing of information. I just strongly suggest that you leverage it and balance it with something that I don't think can be replaced, which is really effective human interaction. So having conversations with people. So where are the times where you can consolidate information? It certainly is helpful when you have geographically dispersed teams, people in different regions of the world. The more you can see each other as you're talking, the more you get to know each other. You can gauge reactions. So technology certainly has its place, but I would encourage you to all consider not letting it take the place of those human conversations. Call me old school, if you will.
Jennifer asks, do you have any suggestions for how you can better build influence with someone who is physically in a different geographic location, mm-hmm. where the ability to have FaceTime is more limited?
I think you have to make time. That's a great question, Jennifer, and more people are struggling with that particular challenge. I think you really have to make time for the face-to-face. So schedule reoccurring sessions just to touch base, even if there's no sort of compelling need to have that conversation. Just do regular touch base. Make sure when you're making decisions in the organization that you take a minute to shoot an email to them saying, hey, Tracy, I'm working on this project. I know we can't talk, but I'd love to get your thoughts, even though from a distance. Can you think about this and get some ideas back to me? We're meeting on it next week. Any way that you can reach out and bring them in, one of the components was involving others, and I think that's a key element to being effective with geographically dispersed teams, is not forgetting they're there. I did a design session where I had members who were critical to the work, but they were remote. And so we videoed them in and literally did whiteboarding and would turn the camera to the whiteboard so they could feel completely engaged as if they were there. In fact, we joked and said we were going to put a hat on the computer screen so that it looked like a real person. But I think it's really about building that connection, albeit virtual.
Thank you. Another question, how do you coach an executive team who wants to surround themselves with yes people?
Oh, Judy, they moved to your organization? I didn't realize that. So what I would say here is you have to figure out how to make the case for what that individual is missing. So yes, people are great, but what's the lost opportunity by not having a more diverse perspective? So I would start there. And it's also about knowing that individual. Is that individual driven by status? Is that person driven by, you know, bottom line? Are they driven just by having their way? But it's how do you tap into that motivation for them so they understand what they're missing by not having people who are going to challenge them more and going to have them think more outside of the box? How do you identify and articulate those longer-term rewards of having some people who say, you know, I hear you, but I'm not so sure I agree, and here's why. So you got to kind of make that compelling case. And if you and the person who prefers those yes folks working for them don't have a relationship, you should start there. Because, again, even though you are 100% right to not surround yourself by all yes people, you have to start with a relationship with that person first and then build that case around why having those different perspectives will be very advantageous to them as an individual and to the organization.
Thank you, Lisa. Question, I have someone new to me that I need to influence on a project. Where do I start?
Oh, great. Well, depending on your organizational context, what the culture is of your organization, I might start with just a meet and greet. Hey, you're new to the organization, stop by their office, stop by their cubicle. Hey, I saw you were new. Let me introduce myself. I'd love to get to know you more. You know, in the time of that, while you're talking to them, in the middle of that conversation, you might say, you know what, I would love to invite you to one of our team meetings and let you meet folks and just talk a little bit about your background. I think it'd be a great way for you to get to know people. So, again, it's reaching out, building that foundation, connecting people with other people. One of the things that I think really helps make you influential is to, not maybe you don't know the answer, but I can connect you to Susan or to George or to Bob down the hall, and they are an expert in that topic. You really ought to reach in and tap them. Hey, and I can send them an email and tell them that I'm going to send them your way because I know them fairly well. So I think it's considering all of those factors too.
Thank you, Lisa. I think we've about reached the end of our time here today. I want to thank everyone for joining us for today's webinar. And thank you, Lisa, for sharing how effective influence better enables individuals and organizations to achieve successful outcomes. We hope that you have enjoyed the session today and will join us for a future webinar. And we are pushing out a webinar evaluation for you, and we hope you'll take a moment to provide some feedback so that we can make these events well worth your time. Also, anyone who completes the evaluation will also be entered into a drawing to receive a free book on direction, alignment, and commitment. Again, thank you for joining us.
Thanks, everybody.
All right. Thank you, everyone. This actually concludes today's webcast. Thank you all for attending. We will send all registrants an email tomorrow with the link to the